The Bahamas Prime Minister defends his decision to fire three government officials over their failure to support a VAT hike for the country. That's our top story in Caribbean Newsline for Thursday, June 21. From the CMC News Center in Bridgetown, I'm Nicole Best. Good evening. A day after three Bahamian government officials had their appointments revoked for refusing to support a hike in value-added tax from 7.5% to 12%, Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis defended his administration's actions. He says it was not personal, but was based on his responsibility and obligation to follow parliamentary procedure. Minnis also said that while his decision may appear tough, his primary focus is on doing what is right and proper now for the future of the country. We get more in this report from ZNS Network News.
MPs were given letters of termination from their government jobs. As a result, MP for Pine Ridge Frederick McAlpine is no longer the chairman of the Hotel Corporation. MP for Baines and Grantstown Travis Robinson Post as parliamentary secretary in the Ministry of Tourism and Aviation was revoked. And member of Parliament for Golden Isles Vaughan Miller's position as parliamentary secretary in the Ministry of Social Development was withdrawn. The nation's leader was asked about the firings, and he says that as prime minister, he has a responsibility to follow cabinet rules and regulations.
I cannot allow my personal views to get into democracy. We have a parliamentary procedure, and I must adhere, respect, and ensure that the parliamentary procedure lives on and is honored and respected thoroughly. We are a democratic society. We practice the Westminster system, parliamentary procedure, and I have certain obligations, and I will ensure that I adhere to my obligations. I'm committed to that, and I must ensure that democracy must always be in the forefront, and democracy must always prevail. I have a responsibility, and I will not shun away from my responsibility.
The budget was passed in the House of Assembly on Monday night and is currently before the Senate for debate. Once approved, the budget is expected to solidify the country's fiscal agenda for the next year. Prime Minister Minnis says this budget has everything to do with the future growth and development of the Bahamas.
I don't concentrate on just what is today. Sometimes one has to make difficult decisions today so that you can have a better tomorrow. And I focus more on tomorrow, but at the same time, ensuring that one has a great today.
But many Grand Bahamians continue to question the government's decision to levy an increase in value-added tax when the local economy continues to struggle.
The Bahamas were poised for 2.5% growth. There are many projects that are coming on stream very soon at Grand Bahama. And we made some decisions that we think would be better for the Bahamas. You see what is happening in Barbados, and I have said, and I would repeat again, I do not want to leave a Bahamas behind where a future prime minister on his first day in office must call some international financial agency for rescue. That is not fair to any future government. And it's my job to ensure that I place the Bahamas in the best possible footing for a future generation.
Trinidad and Tobago's Labour Minister Jennifer Batiste Primus has denied that the government is in collusion with the private sector to undermine the industrial court. Her comments come a day after one union leader said he had an audio recording of a conversation about such a conspiracy allegedly related to reducing the number of judges at the court.
There are certain groups in the society who may be planning to do so. It would be very difficult to undermine, very, very difficult to undermine the industrial court. That is a critical institution within the industrial relations environment in this country.
The Labour Minister responding to questions from TV6 News about claims made on Labour Day.
Friends of the elites in this PNM government are also further planning to weaken the court by what? Reducing the number of existing judges.
I categorically deny that anyone in government is colluding with anyone in the private sector to undermine the industrial court. The industrial court is one of our most important institutions that was built by a PNM administration.
In Barbados, public service vehicle owners are warning that as many as half of the approximately 3,000 workers in the privately run PSV sector could lose their jobs if government insists on implementing its announced petroleum tax. They say the 40 cents per liter levy would have catastrophic results for their business. But interim chairman of the Association of Public Transport Operators, Maurice Lee, says they're making every effort to avoid that happening. He met with the transport minister on Wednesday, and he said that while the meeting was a good one, there's still a need for an urgent and more substantial discussion with the Minister of Finance and even Minister of Energy to resolve their concerns without further delay. It was in Prime Minister and Minister of Finance Mia Motley's mini-budget earlier this month that she announced her administration would abolish road tax from July 1st and replace it with the fuel tax. Meantime, Barbados's Energy Minister Wilfred Abrams said government is seriously considering more energy-efficient options to address the shortage of vehicles at the State-Run Transport Board and the Sanitation Service Authority. He made the disclosure at a CARICOM two-day electric vehicle workshop intended to jumpstart the dialogue on how the region will decrease fuel consumption by transitioning to electric and hybrid electric cars. Abrams said the government will be seeking help to get electric vehicles for public transportation purposes.
Under the Public Sector Smart Energy Program, my ministry is in the process of working with key stakeholders to purchase and pilot much-needed electric buses for Barbados Transport Board with the support of the Inter-American Development Bank and the European Union. Going a little bit off script here, we are also in the process of seeking to solve our garbage truck situation, and I am assured and aware that one of the considerations we're looking at going forward as we replenish our fleet is the provision of electric garbage trucks as well. So we are, as a government, looking at all areas, and we're moving towards where we have to replace vehicles where appropriate, where efficient, or where possible, replacing our fossil fuel fleet with electric vehicles. This pilot will not simply deliver short-term results, but will support future decision-making for the industry.
One-third of Barbados's fuel imports currently go towards transportation, which the minister said relates to about 3,500 barrels of oil every day. But he told the gathering that there are more than 300 electric vehicles on the island's roads, which can save 2,390 barrels of oil in a year.
I'm saying these sound like small figures in the context of everything, but if you compare them to the annual cost of the importation of fossil fuels, we believe we're on the right track to grow this number with the right measures in place. It is noted that Barbados has over 100,000 vehicles in Barbados. We have a population of less than 300,000 people, but we have over 100,000 vehicles on the road. Imagine if only 10% of these vehicles were electric. The savings would be in excess of US$5 million.
Minister Abrams added that the government's long-term plans for the energy sector are aimed at making Barbados the first small island developing state to become 100% green economy by 2030. The electric vehicle workshop, which ended on Thursday, attracted representatives from utility companies that are actively promoting the use of renewable energy, as well as electric car dealers and representatives from Caribbean universities. On Friday, there will be an exhibition of electric cars and other renewable energy technology at the Sir Garfield Sobers Gymnasium. And still to come in Caribbean Newsline, a challenge to a ban on gay marriage in yet another British overseas territory. We'll have the details for that story and more after the break. Do stay with us.
Yeah. Do you wish to combine a vacation with pure laughter? Then St. Martin is the place to be on June 22nd and 23rd for the 14th annual edition of its comedy festival, Laugh Till Belly Burst, with comedians from all over the world. Book hotel and show tickets until June 20th now at www.ltbbsxm.com.
A same-sex couple has filed a legal challenge to the Cayman Islands' ban on gay marriage. Cayman lawyer Chantal Day and her partner Vicky Budden-Bush, a nurse from the UK, have filed for a judicial review of government's decision to refuse their application to marry. In the writ filed on Wednesday, lawyers representing the couple argued that the section of the British Overseas Territories marriage law, which defines marriage as between a man and a woman, is incompatible with various rights guaranteed under the Constitution. They argue that the marriage law has to be modified and reinterpreted in light of the Cayman Islands Bill of Rights, which guarantees the right to private and family life, the right to freedom of conscience, and the right to non-discrimination. The two women are seeking a declaration from the court that the decision to refuse their marriage application was unlawful and that they are entitled to be married in the Cayman Islands. They argue that the decision violates the fundamental rights guaranteed in the Constitution and that they are being discriminated against on the basis of their sexual orientation. If successful, the suit would force the Cayman Islands to follow changes that have occurred in many countries in recent years, given same-sex couples equal access to marriage. Over in Guyana, the Georgetown Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the GCCI, is calling for structured trade relations with Cuba. This call comes as the chamber points to an increase in trade between the two countries. We get more in this report from HGP Nightly News.
Some 700 Cubans visit Guyana every week and are contributing to the country's economic development as trade between the two nations improve. The announcement was made recently by Ambassador of the Republic of Cuba to Guyana, Narciso Rinaldo Amador Socorro. As the local private sector seeks to strengthen ties with its Cuban counterparts, head of the Georgetown Chambers of Commerce and Industry, Deodat Indar, said a more structured mechanism should be put in place to regulate how Cubans conduct their business in Guyana.
We have a lot of Cubans in Guyana. They are flights, at least 1,000 persons every month. It's unregulated to some extent. We believe that this can have some kind of impact on how they do trade, how where they stay, make sure they're not in crime-ridden areas, make sure that people are not exploited.
Guyana and Cuba have been sharing a very good relationship over the years. Recently, the country obtained new rice markets in Cuba. Also, Cuban professionals who work in the local healthcare system continue to provide yeoman service in Guyana.
With the Canadians, we are already seeing a whole lot of what we call joint ventures between Guyanese businesses and Canadian businesses. With the Indian companies, I expect to see more out of it as we work together. Similar like how we've seen successes from the Cubans as well as the Canadians.
According to Mr. Indar, the GCCI took the decision to establish structured bodies to improve trade relations with the three countries following dismal performances of some sectors in 2017. The move by the GCCI received the full blessings of the government.
This is very good, and it's not simply a question of signing an MOU and putting it on the shelf. That's just the beginning of a very long process, and certainly the mechanism of setting up these councils. I want to applaud the chamber for taking this initiative. And on the government side, we are very willing to participate and to do what we can do, because trade facilitation is not just the role of the government or of the private sector. I think it works best when government and private sector are involved in it. So we are supportive and we look forward to seeing developments come out of this initiative.
The minister reminded that trade is an important part of the country's economic expansion, and every effort of this nature is assured of the government's support.
And ahead in Newsline Sports, Shea Hope and Stephanie Taylor named CWI's top cricketers for the year. Stay with us. Sport is next.
This hurricane tip comes to you, compliments the Caribbean Disaster Emergency Management Agency and the Caribbean Media Corporation. Be prepared. A hurricane watch means there is a possibility of a hurricane within 36 hours.
Shea Hope and Stephanie Taylor copped the prestigious Male and Female Cricketers of the Year title at the joint awards of Cricket West Indies and the West Indies Players Association at the Hilton Barbados on Wednesday night. Hope also walked away with both Test and ODI Cricketer of the Year awards, while Taylor earned the ODI title in the women's category. Taylor was not present to accept her awards as she's competing in the Women's Super 50 tournament in Jamaica. Also going home with top honours was Evan Lewis, who was named T20 Cricketer of the Year, while Deandra Dotton was T20 Cricketer of the Year for the females. Kimo Paul was Windies Emerging Cricketer of the Year, while Chadwick Walton copped the Caribbean T20 Cricketer of the Year title. Trinidad and Tobago's Kristin Kelecharan was named West Indies Under-19 Cricketer of the Year, and the Regional Under-19 Team of the Year went to Guyana, which also took the first-class Team of the Year. Meantime, Cricket West Indies President Dave Cameron told those gathered for the awards that the number of professional players in the West Indies has increased from 25 to 177 in 5 years. And he said this is evidence that the region has the number of players to compete internationally.
Australia, on the other hand, has 183 professionals. England, just over 500. And India, just under 700 professional cricketers. I say that to say this is important, that no more can we, as an excuse, use the fact that we don't have enough talent or a pool of talent in the region to compete in world cricket. And we're starting to see that.
Cameron says what is now needed is increased support for players and support staff to ensure the continued development of the sport.
It continues to be a competitive environment for our players, and there are times when decisions may not go your way. We are guaranteed enough cricket through to the next 18 months to ensure that we keep you all in shape. And if one of us see it, we are playing a test match now, test series, our A team in the UK, our B team to go to the Canada, Global T20, which, by the way, Cricket West Indies is a major supporter of that league. And we have 18 matches to play against Bangladesh in very, very short order. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're providing a platform for all of our players across the region And of course, Ghana is one of the ladies who are now playing T20 plays, just finished T20 plays in Jamaica. Congratulations to Jamaica, and the Super 50 tournament for ladies has just started.
Olympic gold medalist Elaine Thompson and Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce and silver medalist Johan Blake are set to compete at this weekend's National Senior Athletic Championships. President of the Jamaica Athletics Administration Association, Dr. Warren Blake, disclosed that all three sprinters had confirmed their participation in the event, which will run alongside the National Junior Athletics Championships at the National Stadium from June 21st to 24th. Senior athletes will be competing for spots on the country's team for next month's World Cup of Athletics in London, as well as the CAC Games and the NACAC Championships. TVJ's Denise Walters tells us more.
Olympic champions Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce and Elaine Thompson headlined the list of top athletes down to compete at the J3A National Senior and Junior Championships from June 21 to 24 at the National Stadium. Both Fraser-Pryce and Thompson will contest the women's 100 meters, but it is Fraser-Pryce whose season is looking the better of the two. The Pocket Rocket, in her third competitive race since giving birth to her son, won at the Jane Racers Grand Prix recently.
I'm glad that I took that time off and I had him, because he's like an extra motivation and also extra energy and refreshing for me to come back here. I am just pumped and ready to go. For me, it's just about a race at a time and trying to, you know, execute the phases of the 100. Still some way to go, but I'm really excited about the time and excited about the progress.
On the men's side, 2015 World Youth Champion Christopher Taylor is set for the 400 meters in the senior section of the championships. This event will see a new champion being crowned, as last year's winner Nathan Allen will not be competing. In recent weeks, Taylor won the 400 meters at the Cayman Invitational in a personal best 45.24 seconds, defeating the likes of national record holder Rasheen McDonald and former national champion Javon Francis. Prior to that, he made the decision to go up against the big men and won the 200 meters at the Jamaica International Invitational, beating the likes of LaShawn Merrick.
So far, I have had the fastest time as a junior in the world, so I decided to ask coach if I could go with the seniors, and he said he would check it out for me, and he did, and I got in and just come out and execute.
Meanwhile, president of the J3A, Dr. Warren Blake, earlier this year told TVJ Sports that the National Senior Championships would be used specifically to select a team for the inaugural Athletics World Cup from July 14 to 15 in London.
It would only be natural that we would be looking to use our national championships to select the team.
Only one male and female athlete from the field and track events across the 17 disciplines, along with two male and female relay teams, will compete in straight finals. The USA, Great Britain, France, Germany, Poland, South Africa, and China are the other countries confirmed for the event.
Over to football, Bermudan striker Naki Wells has pledged to end his three-year international exile and make himself available for his country's most important games. Wells, who plays for English Premier League club Burnley, made the commitment during an interview with the Royal Gazette newspaper while enjoying a break in his homeland. He said he had been briefed by the Bermuda Football Association about the tournament, and he's excited by the prospect of regular, meaningful international fixtures. With the nation's need to be played on FIFA international dates, Bermuda will look to call on their top overseas-based players, including Wells and midfielder Reggie Lamb, who is searching for a new club after being released by English League two-side Carlisle United. Bermuda will play four qualifying matches to determine the three divisions for the Nations League, which starts in September 2019, as well as the 10 remaining Gold Cup spots. Barbadian jockey Patrick Husbands kept up his steady tempo at Woodbine this season, landing a double on Wednesday's midweek card at the popular Western Canada Oval. The seven-time champion produced a narrow score in the day's opener with 5-7 chance Super Duper Sky before returning to win race four with 12-5 choice Foresters Forum. The 45-year-old Husbands opened his account over a mile and 16th when he steered four-year-old filly Super Duper Sky to victory by a header over the three-year-olds and upward fillies and mares. And that's the sport. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Your heart to the 22nd annual St. Kitts Music Festival from June 27th to July 1st, 2018, featuring Kester Band, Sizzler Good Lodgy, Small. Sector, New Vibes International, Rhythm of the Beat, and Wayne Wonder. Five, August Alcina, Aishana, Byron Messiah, Lesha, Shaka Dimas, and Flyers, and Miss Lauren Hill. Save the date and book now for the 22nd Annual St. Kitts Music Festival, an experience like no other.
Again, the major developments of this day, the Bahamas Prime Minister, Dr. Hubert Minnis, defends his decision to fire three government officials over their failure to support a VAT hike for the country. And in sport, Shea Hope and Stephanie Taylor cop the prestigious Male and Female Cricketer of the Year titles. That's Caribbean Newsline. For news and sport around the clock, subscribe to carnanews.com. For more of our programming, log on to caribvision.tv and subscribe to Carib Vision's YouTube channel. We'll be back here again tomorrow. But from all of us at CMC News, thank you for watching and do have yourselves a good night.